coming to Northeast Wisconsin live from the Civic Media Studios at the City Deck Landing in Green Bay and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Maino, along with the City of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Maino and the Mayor. Here are your hosts, John Maino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back. Maino and the Mayor here on a good-looking Thursday morning. Special thanks to Big Kaz for coming on.
Great.
Sounds like he's going to get you bear meat again for the community shelter.
Isn't that nice of him? And that it's fun to have residents, the 108 people who are there, and have fun with a Packer game, right?
Yeah.
Because remember when Ace came in and he did the... Jambalaya when we played the Saints.
Which was phenomenal.
That was really good.
Really good.
Then Kaz got us the bear meat. And they can learn that. You can have a lot of fun without alcohol and really enjoy.
We might be able to do a fish fry for you sometime.
That would be awesome.
Go out and get a bunch of perch. I got some other guys
to
do it. We'll do that. They would love that. We'll do a perch fry.
They are very appreciative. And, you know, they just haven't grown up and lived maybe like you and I have and our guests.
Eating raw meat.
I heard about that before.
Oh.
Is that the best?
Very special guest, Mandy Wilkie. She does lots and lots of things around the community. Stroll Ledgeview Magazine is one of the biggest, but exactly the type of person we try to get on this show, people that are really involved with the community, people that are really, you know,
entrepreneurial,
and you fit exactly in the type of person we're trying to get on. Right, Todd? And we talk about this when we talk about what kind of a show you're going to have. Totally community-based, and the people that make the communities what they are. So welcome.
Yeah, thank you. And you guys have been doing such a great job lately, too. I've seen a lot of people that I'm connected to. And it's just fun because you see them in a totally different light when they get to come and do something like this than on their day-to-day job.
Awesome.
So thanks
good.
For having me.
Oh, it's great to have you.
Yeah.
So with your entrepreneurial business, I want to talk about that because I love the entrepreneur. I really encourage people to do it. And I don't want people sitting around when they're in their 60s saying, I wish I would have done that.
This whole segment, just so you know, is tailor-made for him. So I'm just going to kind of let him.
I'm just here for you.
No. We'll do this all together. But what was the impetus to start your business? You're talking about you worked for a pretty good sized company before.
Yeah. So the first time was on accident. I went to, in the playground industry, I shared that with you a little bit. So that was completely on accident. I went to interview for a business administrative role in his office. And he's like, I'm going to put you in sales and you're going to work on commission. And I was like, no, I'm 24 years old. I don't think that sounds like a good idea. And I did that until I was about 35. So very part-time when I moved here. I did it full-time in the Chicago area. That market has a lot of money for playgrounds. There's a lot of government funding. Did really well with it. Loved it. It was fun. Nobody thought it was a job. You know, designing, building, creating playgrounds was a job. So did that, had a big life change later in life. I had a third baby 10 years after my first two, and I decided to retire from the playground industry. Then went through another life change and went through a divorce. And in that situation, I was like, okay, I haven't worked full time in a long time. What can I do to earn income, be flexible, have control of how good I am at it, not be at the mercy of anybody else, and... this was the franchise that I picked.
Stroll. I will say one thing, though, and Jim studies this kind of stuff. Everything you're talking, he studies this because he's big into what separates a business or a person that makes it versus not. And sometimes there's small little things. But I will say this. If you can make it as a salesperson, you can pretty – you've got a big head start. Don't you agree, Jim?
Yeah, that does help because communication is what we're talking about.
I've always been a relationship person and being able to connect. That's kind of my gifting. So to put it to work, to make some money doing it was a win.
And Johnny said, I love the entrepreneur and I won a couple of awards, but I teach it. I study it, but I really teach it. And I tell the students kind of what you're just saying, is that this whole, communications relationship, because people spend a lot of money on advertising.
They do.
And it may be worth it, but it may not be. You may to go over market. You know, you advertise for something in Green Bay on one of the TV stations. Well, there's a million people who watch in their market. So people in Appleton and Oshkosh are seeing it. And if like me, right? I campaigned. Well, people down there aren't going to vote for me. So you want to be really careful that you're targeting your market, but no better advertising than a relationship, right?
Well, it's true. And I have a coach within our company. And, you know, when things aren't going the way that I want them to do, the first question she asked me is, are you out and about? because when I'm out and about in the community, generally things happen and people want to be a part of what's going on. But if I'm working at home and nobody sees me.
Okay, guy, if I can just jump in there, that's the same philosophy we have with this. In fact, one of our guys here corporate the other day told Todd when Jim and I were talking about what we're doing at lunch, he goes, wow, those guys, what do you say? These guys are really...
Something about that you guys are out in the community, you're getting involved with stuff, and that just automatically lends itself to promoting the show and the stations.
Firm believer in that.
Yeah, when people see you, they want to know what you're doing. Yep. They want to be a part of something.
So yesterday we were at two ribbon cuttings. Today Earth Day is on Monday or Tuesday, we're going to pick up trash today with a group of people at Whitney Park. So I think they'd be involved in the community. And the other thing, besides them seeing you, is you hear what they're looking for.
Right. I mean, 50% of my job is the sales side and the advertising side, but the other 50% is working for the residents that get my magazine.
Right.
So whatever they're doing, I can facilitate connection, community, involvement. So if you said to me, we're going to pick up trash, Mandy, do you want to invite any of the residents from Stroll to do that? I can do that.
Yeah.
And then now we get the people out in the community differently. So if they want to support a 501c3 or they sit on a board or they want to write an article about something great in the community, they can do that as long as they get the magazine. They just need to reach out to me to do it.
So there's a lot of franchises out there, right? Yeah. Everybody thinks about McDonald's and Subway, but there's just a lot of franchises out there. You chose, what's the name of your franchise?
Well, I'm Stroll Ledgeview.
Yeah, I know that.
But the comb company is the N2 company.
The N2 company.
Yeah.
So you chose Stroll Ledgeview Magazine.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of authority with that. And I want to talk about the marketing because I want to get into your podcast. Because I think today, you want the relationships and you want the advertising, but podcasts are where it's at. And you've got a successful one. And I want you to tell our listeners
It's new, but I love that you call it successful. It's so exciting. So kind of to backtrack a little bit, even though I'm in the world of advertising, right? I've been doing this for 6 years in this market with the magazine. And I'm very transparent about what my job is because I think in advertising, it's really difficult. You know, anybody that's been in sales and advertising for years knows that results are really hard, right? And there definitely is things like ROI and tracking phone numbers and QR codes and all of that. But at the end of the day, I make one promise to anybody who partners with me in my magazine. And that's that more neighbors that get my magazine will know about you tomorrow than they did yesterday.
Great point.
Whether or not they call you, use you, you answer your phone, you do a good job, or you're in the price market, I can't control that.
Right.
What I can control is if we knock on 150 doors today, more, and those same 150 doors in 2 years, more people will know about you and they'll probably have a connection to you and a trust to you because they've seen about your business so much they can't unsee you. That's it. That's all. That I'm pretty transparent. I don't want anyone to think I'm going to get them like 100 leads or anything like that.
And
we have services that can do that.
One thing we always ask people like yourself, number one, what's the big pitfall? Number two, what advice would you give to somebody that's trying to do something, not specifically like you, but kind of go out on their own and take that walk in space without that safety net?
Yeah. Pitfall from me and my business, you mean? I would think for me, it's I'm fairly connected. And a lot of people have an expectation that is somewhat unrealistic when you have 70, 80, 90 partners and you're trying, you know, my job is to put your ad in the magazine.
Right.
Right. But I think a lot of people think that I should do another social media post or I should connect them to a person or I should invite them over to a neighbor's house for dinner. And all those things can happen and sometimes do, but it's not a promise that I make. So I think the downside is some people want my personality or my network. They don't care as much about the magazine. But at the end of the day, I have to make sure they understand that the magazine is the package that they're paying for.
Gotcha.
So that's probably a pitfall.
That's not a bad pitfall. I mean, I most of it is...
It's my own problem because I want to do the best I can for everybody.
I'm really complimenting you on that.
Thank you.
Most pitfalls are undercapitalized.
Yeah.
Didn't really understand the market, the business, the industry I was getting into.
Not enough research.
We talk about market research.
Yeah.
But you did all that.
Well, I did. And it's a franchise model that's been running since 2004.
So that takes a little bit of the risk.
Yeah. So I had a platform to follow. This kind of going back when you said you teach entrepreneurship, when I was 24, I'll probably get this wrong because I'm 25 now.
Yeah, me too.
But I'll probably get this wrong. But the guy that hired me, and I had never done sales, I was right out of college. And he's like, you need to make 10 calls. From the 10 calls, you need 5 appointments. From the 5 appointments, you need 3 meetings. From the 3 meetings, you need 1 sale. And then you need the referral. And he made me do that every single day.
Yeah.
So every
single cold calls?
Well, yeah.
Oh,
I started Stroll Ledgeview, I did 100 cold calls.
I worked
a day
for that guy too.
Yeah. Mike Schramm. Let's give a shout out to Mike Schramm.
It wasn't him.
But he set that precedence for me. So when you ask about entrepreneurship and the dedication, when things are struggling, that's what I go back to. Did I do that today? Did I do the work? Because it's really easy to say, well, I'm going to throw a little laundry in. The UPS guy came and he delivered a book that I want to read. So I'm going to start reading it right now. Oh, yeah. When we have other things that we have to do, right? So
it's that mental discipline you have to bring to the table.
You have to have the discipline. You have to have the desire. Yeah. I mean, everybody loves the flexibility. Yeah. But if you don't do the work, you don't have the flexibility. And right. You certainly don't make the money.
Yeah.
Right?
Great point.
But
one of the things Jim and I, we've noticed with the young entrepreneurs that we bring in here is like we have this one young lady that we just hold in the highest esteem. She was a first generation Chinese.
Okay.
Parents didn't speak English. Wow. Started with nothing. Went to join the military just so she could pay for college.
Wow.
Get sent to Afghanistan. I mean, hardcore Afghanistan.
She's impressive. Yeah.
Yes. So then she decided she wanted to start up this juice company type thing. She would go day after day after day for 6 to 8 hours and just sit and observe and observe and observe on what to do right and what to do wrong. And now she's a tremendous success. Yeah, right, Jim?
That's amazing.
And her research was, she got the money from, what do you call those loans? So she got some kind of government. They helped her. Yeah. So that, and she put a lot of her own money into it. But
like a startup loan.
It was a startup. Yeah, exactly. But the big mistakes that are made is this research. And for her to spend months sitting in a competitor's office, in a competitor's juice bar, whatever they—
just watching.
And then the research she did with her customers on what they really like. And she was rattling off what's in the juices. And she had no menu in front of her. I mean, she knows that business. And if I were a banker, and you hear this all the time, they really lend money to the person, not the business.
100%.
They do.
Yeah.
And you go in there and you start talking about the industry and then you start talking about your niche. If you can connect those two, you know, they're probably going to roll the dice. But I don't know that for sure. But
I started my business through a tough story. She started with a story. Mm-hmm. When you have an entrepreneur that has a story and has a passion, it becomes part of your life.
Right.
And it's not just a job. Right. It's your passion and that exudes to people and they want to be a part of something.
Right.
And I we also had the lady from Menasha who started up a place like a hoagies place.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
From the south side of Chicago, you know, the whole thing came up here.
She
started this up. It was voted best in the Fox Valley.
She found a niche because everybody has sub sandwiches and hoagies, but she had something in Chicago that we didn't have here, and she brought that, and she hit a home run with that.
I love it.
And awesome. So do we.
Can you stick around, Mandy?
Yeah.
Mandy Wilkie, Stroll Ledge Room Magazine, and a whole bunch of other things in her entrepreneurship. We'll be back right after this. Stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets, the traffic starts jumping. With folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living. Barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and they never give you credit. It's enough to drive you crazy. No matter what they call. Welcome back. Maino the Mayor here at 97.9 FM, WGBW, 98.3 FM, WISS, and the Civic Media app. Nice morning out there, 48 degrees in Green Bay, 45 in Appleton, 44 in Oshkosh. Coming up down the road here just a little bit, Mary Jane Herber, the local historian who knows everything there is to know about Green Bay history. And I'm not even being facetious when I say that.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Also, Chef Ace Champion, who is amazing, amazing chef. An amazing talk about his flute festival in Madison. We got Pat Trace from Discover Oshkosh. But right now, Mandy Wilkie from Stroll Edgeview Magazine. Really, and for young entrepreneurs, or even if you're not young, and you want to get into this, you're talking about some of the things that Jim absolutely preaches on how to go about.
Well, you're a featured business of the week, a small business. And I just compliment you for taking the risk because there's a risk. Even it's a franchise, but it's a risk.
Yeah, I mean, I would 0 out of 10 recommend starting your own business in the middle of a divorce. That's not a great idea.
Right.
And it took about 6 months to get it going, which is standard in our industry. Sure. So, you know, starting a business on unemployment, essentially, while going through all that wasn't easy. So I would 0 out of 10, like I said, recommend. But the opportunity was something I had to fight through it.
You could have taken an easier way and you could have gone to one of our local big box stores and no disrespect to the people that work in those stores or anything, but you could have done that, gotten a regular paycheck and, you know, but you wouldn't have been happy, right?
I wouldn't have been happy. I needed the flexibility. I needed, through a tough time in our personal life, I needed to be there for my kids. And I also needed my own purpose. And I needed to have something I was passionate about and look forward to. So I will remember.
And you didn't have a safety net.
I didn't really have a safety net. I mean, the unemployment check wasn't that big. Right. So I remember one of my girlfriends saying, so let me get this straight. In the middle of your kind of misery situation, because it's divorce is tough. You're going to go into people's beautiful homes and you're going to get to know them and talk about their perfect lives while your family's kind of falling apart. I'm like, well, I can aspire to be like them or I can live over here in my misery. And that's the route I chose.
You know, so. I was talking to a guy the other night after the banquet we were at, Jim, after the GB steak fry, and he came up to me and goes, hey, John, I appreciate what you do with the military, blah, blah, blah. He says, I'm a veteran. I said, you know, what branch? And he says, Marines. And I said, you know, I'll tell you what, there's about 14 reasons why I could never be a Marine. But I said, I'll tell you the number one. I said, one of the recruiters took me out to San Diego a couple of years ago to do a video for him that he can use for training. And I said, these guys have to go over, it's this unbelievable, it's Stairway to Hell, I think it's called, where it's like telephone poles, all horizontal, but different things apart from each other.
Yeah.
And they have to climb to the very top and do a thing and then take a rope and go down or whatever, okay?
Yeah.
And I said, you know what? I said, I could never do that. He says, well, you would.
You would.
I said, yeah. No, I don't know. He says, trust me on this. You're more worried about what the consequences are if you don't do it than mm-hmm. if you do. I said, but there's no safety net. It's just sawdust. He says, that's the number one thing that will inspire you to do it.
There is no safety net. There was no plan B for me.
Exactly.
You know, when I decided there was no plan B, because I did, when I was deciding whether or not to do this, I did have the, should I just go to somebody that has health insurance?
Right.
That, you know, has these things and that it's steady. Maybe absolutely. I won't make as much money, but it's steady.
But you know, on Tuesday or whatever, there's a paycheck.
Yeah. But I just couldn't do it. I needed to go this route.
That's awesome.
Good for you. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure when your friend said, wait, let me get this straight, that you're going to go into people's homes and see their perfect life. They don't all have perfect lives.
Wink, wink, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
At the end of the day, the people in Ledgeview, it's definitely a highly affluent target market, but they're all people.
I tell students that too. It's like, look, you guys, it may look that way, but I guarantee you, I know a lot of people, and they all have some issue, right?
Yeah.
That they're struggling with. But anyway, yeah. I think that's great that you bring them together and you connect them with each other through Stroll Ledgeview Magazine. Talk to us a little bit about marketing. And I know you said relationships is your number one, which mm-hmm. I think it should be for any business. And I mean any business, automotive, restaurants, politics. But there's other things to do. And tell me a little bit more about the podcast, why you got into it.
The podcast was also an accident. I feel like a lot of things in my life are an accident now. The podcast was an accident. I was sitting at Taza Coffee Shop with a couple of friends that are business owners that we see all the time. Coffee shop seems to be our second home sometimes. And we all had just this morning where we were kind of like, hey, has this ever happened to you? Hey, has this ever happened to you? And we had the 10-minute conversation at the end. I don't remember which one of the three of us was like, we should just do a podcast and talk about this stuff instead of sitting here in the coffee shop. And a month later, we had a podcast.
So tell me then, and some, I think people think, oh, should I have a podcast?
You got to care less about what people think.
Right. True that.
That is, you know what? If you need to put together the Ten Commandments, if you want to make it.
Number one.
Stop worrying about what people think.
Who gives
think.
A God. Beep.
Yep, right. Exactly. Right.
Yeah.
But what's the name of your, so if we want to listen in, that sounds interesting. What's the name of it?
It's called The Real Chat Podcast, which is what it sounds like. It's for entrepreneurs, but it's about real stuff. Right. So we don't want to sugarcoat it, but we don't want to be negative about it all either. Three entrepreneurs from the community. We're all very community-based businesses. We've had a few guests on, not as many as we'd like, but we're still trying to figure out how we want to do that. But we started last fall. We started airing in January. We had 10 episodes. We're on a little break now because not me, but one of the podcasters had a new baby. So we gave him a couple of weeks off. Yep. So we'll be coming back. But we've had a few guests on, and we have a list of people that we'd like to have on that have been very successful entrepreneurs in Green Bay, young and old.
I got to just say one thing that you kind of just hit on about you don't want to discourage people. There's that fine line, and Jim talks about this, kind of like a fine line between being realistic with people, with his students, basically, that he has in his classes, without discouraging them. There is a fine line between the two, isn't there?
There's a very fine line. You have to be honest.
Right.
I tell people you have to be honest. So what was the honest background to my business? It sucked for 6 months.
And that's
okay. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's okay.
But 6 months, and now I'm 6 years out? Like, that's a blip. That's when you can't drink alcohol when you're pregnant. 9 months, you just struggle through it. And then when you get on the other side,
that's why we're guys.
Yeah. I think my mom smoked when she was pregnant for me, but it didn't bother me at all.
Yeah.
I think Johnny makes a good point, because if you really look at the realism, it could get discouraging. You know,
it still the does. Percent,
but people want to start restaurants. And what's the failure rate? I mean, business in general, there's a high failure rate, but some are less risky than others. But we tell people that if you really got the passion, I mean, look at your research again.
Right.
And then check your capital. And if you think you have enough runway for 2 months, go back and get it for 6 months or 8 months. You know what I mean? You got to have everybody. The first year is easy. You just burn through your investment money. But then it's like, okay, the second year, oh my God, we're not hitting the sales number. So they just got to talk about it. And
I think the difference is there's an entrepreneur that has an idea that's starting from scratch. And there's an entrepreneur that picked up a program. I picked up a program. It was done for me. I knew I was a disciplined person. So if I could do the work, the numbers were going to work out. I just had to do the work. So there's two different types, in my opinion, of entrepreneurship. There's the entrepreneur that has the idea that they want to run with and they're doing it completely on their own. And then there's one that's following a model that's been done before them. Yeah. I'm still an entrepreneur, but there is a franchise model that I can fall back on.
I was going to say fall back on in those days where
when it gets
this
tough.
Isn't working.
Like,
what do I do?
Am I doing the intro in my meeting? Yeah. Let me go back and check. Yeah.
Yep. Excellent. Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Yeah.
All right. We only have 1 minute left, but one more last thing, Mandy. Yeah. And I just mentioned this is Mandy Wilkie, Stroll Ledger Magazine. One tip. Anybody out there, one of Jim's students from his marketing class sitting out there right now, one tip to give them.
Talk to as many entrepreneurs as you can.
Okay.
That's great advice because they all have their stories. And I think entrepreneurs I don't want to generalize, but they're pretty honest people.
Honest. Yeah. And they really have a desire to help other entrepreneurs no matter what their industry is.
Totally.
Because they've been there.
Yeah.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
Mandy Wilkie, thank you so much. This is awesome. You've been fantastic. We want to listen to your podcast when it's up, all right?
Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much. Mary Jane Herber, local historian at the Green Bay Public Library, will be joining us. Ace champion coming up down the road. Maino the Mayor, back after this.
Download the Civic Media app today from the Apple Store or Google Play Store and text the studio directly, all from the Civic Media app. Download it today. Now, once again, here's Maino and the Mayor, John Maino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back to Maino and the Mayor. We're having a great, fun Thursday. Mandy Wilkie from Stroll Ledgeview Magazine and my buddy Big Cause on talking about being a lineman during these storms they've had, and now one of their favorite people in all of Green Bay, Mary Jane Herber, librarian, historian, Green Bay Public Library, and I'm not kidding
you.
Brown County Library. I'm sorry. but I just want to say, in the books I wrote, you helped me so much. You pointed me in the right direction for my World War II books. But the most fun thing, and this is the reason I got so many parking tickets, because the mayor we had at that time instituted a one-hour parking ban at the library. He didn't want people hanging out at the library. He wanted them hang out in the body shop where you get a lot more time with your quarter. So, but anyway.
That's why I ran and won.
That damn Halloween, huh?
It was Jaden before me.
Oh, Jaden. That's right. Damn Jaden. But Mary, and I'd go through that microfilm. But what I'm saying is, Mary, I learned more about Green Bay going through old newspapers at the library with that microfilm than you could ever learn from a book. Isn't that a fantastic access you have there to learn about Green Bay?
Well, the newspaper collection is just wonderful. We have just about every newspaper that's ever been published in Green Bay on every reel of film.
That's phenomenal.
And back to 1833, first paper in Wisconsin.
And in that historical, a lot of people go up there for genealogy, but you have all the yearbooks. I think that's really cool.
Oh, I had so much fun looking at those yesterday. Why won't you let me check those out?
Because they won't come back, John.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, all right.
Wow. She knows me so well.
As nice as she is, she's honest. Know,
right? Oh, you want honesty? Her name is Mary Jane. Mary Jane, Green Bay, the legacy of Green Bay. Correct me if I'm wrong. I've been here since 1984. And for the first 10 years or so I was here, there didn't seem to be a really huge mission of really acknowledging our tremendous history. It seems like that's really turned, and you've been a big part of that. We've got such a legacy here in Green Bay. One of your main jobs is restoring that, isn't it?
Well, I think that one of the things you have to do is keep people that they're able to identify with what they're doing and what was there before them.
Yeah.
And you have to focus not only on stuff from the 1700s and the 1800s. You have to focus on what's happened since the First World War, what's happened since the Second World War. I mean, when you look at the time frame after the Second World War and what happened in the community and what was completed in a short period of time in terms of water to the lake, in terms of the stadium, in moving, you know, from
City behind, Stadium to Lambeau.
Yeah, behind East High to what's now Lambeau Field. And you think about the City Hall, new City Hall being built, new post office being built downtown, the number of things that happened in Green Bay in that time frame. But it's also because all those guys came back from the war and they were used to working together. They didn't always agree. They probably had battles in the city council minutes. You know, we don't have good recordings of all that. But the next week they went out for a beer because they knew they had a mission. They knew what it was. They were used to working together during the war. They may not have always agreed, but they knew if they didn't work together, somebody wasn't coming
back. What a great
back.
Point. What a fantastic point that is, Mary Jane.
You know, and
in fact, one of the things I learned from my guys, those, you know, because they grew up during the Depression. Yep. They were literally starving almost, some of these guys. I mean, you know, when they went in the army, they said they'd write to their mom. It's like, you're not even going to believe this. We can eat as much as we want, three meals a day. They hadn't had that almost in their lifetime. But then, you know, when I talked to them, I'd say, what did you do when you came back? And they said, well, you know, I got married, built the house here. And, you know, I said, oh, you're a carpenter. Oh, no, I worked at the foundry. I said, oh, I thought when you said you built the house, you actually, he goes, yeah, me and my brother. I said, how'd you know how to build a house? He said, well, what else are you going to do? You couldn't afford to hire anybody. We built the house. They were so self-sufficient.
Yes, that's I the last couple of years, well, I do a tour for Leadership Green Bay every year. And the last couple of years, I've gone out to a different part of the community, and I turned on a street by accident when I was planning it again. And I thought, oh my gosh, these are all the little GI Bill houses that were built all over the place. They're all over. And I remember talking to Jake Rose years ago, and because I had a question about mortgage rates and stuff.
Just for the listeners, Jake Rose was the president of Kellogg Bank, very dedicated to this community. Actually, the Welcome Center in City Hall is named after him because he was just such a great person. Go ahead.
Yeah. Anyway, I drove down this street and I looked at it and I thought, oh my gosh, I remember him telling me that the interest rates were 4%. 52, 51, you know, back then, and that there were only 10-year mortgages.
Oh, my gosh.
10-year mortgages on those little houses, 2-3 bedrooms, one-stall garage kind of things. And I realized when I was driving around this street a couple of weeks later, I thought, oh, all those guys with those skills you were just talking about, John. Yeah. And some were carpenters and some were cement men and some were plumbers and electricians.
They were hands-on guys.
You know what they did next after that mortgage was paid off?
What?
Well, think about it. They were in their 30s.
Built a cabin?
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. They bought that 100 feet on a lake or the river up north, and that's where those cottages all started.
And credit to the community for having jobs that they could do that.
Yep.
I mean, Green Bay's strength, one of the Green Bay's biggest strengths is how diverse they are in their economy. Like at Two Rivers, they had all their eggs in like two baskets. That's not a good idea. You know, here we have, you know, we have the paper, we have the health care,
got the port.
Right. Yeah. So a diverse economic base, and I think that helped. And when they make enough money to build and buy and pay off a house, get a snowmobile, and then get a cabin up north, that's pretty good living.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Not available in a lot of other parts of the country for people who have the kind of jobs that we all think are good jobs,
right?
You know, that pay well. But in other parts of the country, you'd never be able to have two houses.
Right.
Yeah. You know, one of the guys, he was assigned to a unit. Well, actually, I've talked to you about this. The former mayor, Sam Hallowen, who's in one of my books, and he was in World War II. He was a medic in World War II in serious, serious fighting. And one of the tough things that happened to him is he was assigned to a unit from Texas. And he said it was basically they were still fighting the Civil War, and they looked at the Yankees as their enemy, and he had overcome that. But he said some of these guys came from such nothing, these poor guys. You know what I mean? It was incredible. He says, you realize, remember him saying how good we had it, no matter how tough things were in Green Bay or wherever, versus these guys down in the Dust Bowl areas. He said, you can't believe it.
Yeah. it's part of the reason why, you know, when you talk about the Dust Bowl and you think about, you know, now we're going to veer off a little bit in terms of family history, but you, when you're working on things about your family and about a community, it's always good to look at the censuses. And part of the reason why is when you look at the 1940 census, it asked, were you living in the same place in 1935? And one of the reasons why it did that was because of the Depression. So the, if you think of the guys that were at the CCC camps.
Right, absolutely.
You know, in 35, they were someplace else possibly.
Yeah.
You know, and but what it does show is it shows the stability in this area in terms of housing. Sometimes people went home to the farm because the rest of the family was on the farm and they just happened to be in town. But when you get to the census in terms of other parts of the country, in California, it's going to say Oklahoma, Kansas, et cetera.
They moved there.
Because they moved because of the Dust Bowl.
But so, here, they're probably just stayed the whole time. But, you know, another thing you talk about CCC, I remember talking to my dad about that because we were studying in school. I said, wow, that must have been tough for those kids from Detroit, got sent up here to work in the woods or whatever. He goes, are you kidding? I go, what do you mean? He goes, I tried everything in the world to get into the CCCs. To us, that was the greatest thing in the world. You get to work out in the woods, you get paid, you get fed, you play. He said that was the greatest thing. But what they were doing during that time, at least in Michigan, they were taking some of those kids from the real disadvantaged parts of Detroit and places like that and bringing them up to the UP.
Sure.
But he said that was a phenomenal program.
Yeah. Well, you know, there are a lot of those programs that developed, and it also, the CCC camps.
And by the way, let me just say, we're with Mary Jane Herbert, librarian, historian, Brown County Library, but also CCC stands for Civilian Conservation Corps. Okay, go ahead.
Yes. Oh, that's right. I say WPA to people, and they go, what?
Yeah.
But it's just interesting to see how all those things connect, and that's where history is an important thing, because you can't take one thing and have it stand alone. It's dependent on other things, and there are parts of communities that exist.
And you know that, being the librarian historian for the county, but when you look at our history and how diverse it is, like the churches, mm-hmm. I mean,
oh, yeah.
French, Irish,
Belgian,
yep,
Germans,
Polish,
yep. Oh, yeah, Polish, St. Mary's.
And Belgian? What, you said Belgian.
Yeah. Chinese,
but
yeah.
Well, you know, it's funny. I was in Manitowoc the other day. I was driving past the cemetery. I told Julie, I said, it's got to be a Polish area. She said, well, yeah, it was St. Mary's Church. I was concerned. But it's just funny. Every name on a tombstone had SKYs and stuff.
Yeah.
But the thing is even in you know, there's the Norwegian, it's Norwegian Lutheran, German Lutheran. You know, there's the different aspects of the community that are based on those ethnic groups that came from Northern Europe for the most part.
And some were persecuted. Like Jim and I were talking the other day. I said there was this place in Denmark where they rebuilt a church with local labor and everything. It's a fantastic story with what they did. But he took me down into the basement, almost like a dungeon, where there are these benches. And it was one sect of the Lutheran church right straight from Germany. And they were different than the others. So they had to almost, you know, worship privately. And that was such a big part of Northeast Wisconsin, was the religion, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, you know, I have an uncle that was, well, I still have family that are farmers, but I always remember at my uncle's funeral, his grandson got up and said, my grandfather always told us this, God has given you everything you have. He only asks for 1 hour a week.
Yeah.
You know?
That makes sense.
Right.
Yep.
And then, but it's amazing, you do that church walk, you know, they do that around Christmas,
yeah,
how close they are, you know,
yes,
and they're all down here. Hey, I want to just go a little bit more into what you offer at the library.
Yes.
Everybody knows, you know, library, books, magazines, but let's talk a little bit more about the history, genealogy. Is that's really becoming a thing, right?
Yeah, well, you know, it has ebbs and flows a little bit, but we had the genealogy 101 programs from January into the first part of April because we skipped Easter.
COVID. Oh,
well,
okay.
We skipped Easter, et cetera, yeah, so we didn't. And we had about 1,600 people over the 10 weeks.
Isn't that amazing?
Amazing.
1,600 people took advantage of those courses that you offer on genealogy.
Yeah. We had people that come in from out of county, come over from Two Rivers and Manitowoc and from the Valley and over in Shawano and O'Connell counties. So it's not just Brown County people that
come in. It's something that's fairly recent, ever since the advent of the internet, basically, right?
Well, we've been doing it for about 20 years now.
Oh, you have that lot?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. And part of it is because when I used to do it at NWTC, and it was so buried in their catalog because they had so much in their catalog in terms of cooking and all that, it usually didn't fill up, you know, because people couldn't find it. And so finally, after about 20 years ago, I said, let's just do this at the library. And we did, and we've been doing it ever since.
It's been so popular.
It has. And people have been on the show, and we've also talked to people that really appreciate what they can learn.
And they're amazed.
And they're amazed at you in your department. And you're very helpful, too, I want to say. Very.
Well, the other part of it is it's just gotten gotten easier because of the internet.
Right.
I mean, it used to be that you had to go through the census manually. Although the good thing about going through it on microfilm was that you'd find things where by accident, whereas now people have a tendency to put in what they want to find.
And
they don't
find.
That's right. They don't get the browsing aspect of it where they find things by accident.
For people that have a chance to go back and look at the microfilm of the old press, what an amazing newspaper that was.
Oh, it's great.
And incredible.
Great paper.
And you know, Cliff Crystal, who I know you know very well, who's just the expert on the Packers, has spent a lot of time in your area.
Cliff spent so much time at the library with the microphone before all this database stuff. Is that I'd go out at 10 o'clock in the morning, and he'd be out on a microfilm reader.
Yeah.
And I'd go back out, you know, because it's in a different space from where the local history department is. And I'd go out like at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and he'd still be sitting there. I'd say, do you need something to eat?
Like to know how many parking tickets he got over the years. Back when
he walked there.
Back with the former mayor. Mary Jane Herbert, librarian, historian, Brown County Library. Can you stick around after this break?
Yep.
Thank you very much. Ace Champion coming up down the road here. Pat Tracy, Discover Oshkosh. Maino the Mayor, back after this.
Try to dig what we all say. I'm not trying to cause a big sensation. Just because we could get around.
Hey, welcome back. Maino the Mayor here, 97.9 FM WGBW, 98.3 FM WISS, and of course the Civic Media app. Mary Jane Herber, librarian, historian, Brown County Library, our very special guest.
Yeah, we talk about, Mary Jane, the quality of living here in Green Bay, right? Or Brown County, I should say. We just received that recognition, a year and a half ago, being the best place to live. And I think people, Packers, crime, and those are very important things, but I think the library is a little bit underrated, especially when the history and everything that you offer, especially on your department.
Well, part of it, I want to say right at the beginning here, when we're talking about the library, is we're State Library of the Year again.
That's awesome. That's congratulations.
Congrats.
This is about the third that I know of for sure. Third time, if not maybe the fourth time that we've been State Library of the Year. And part of it is because, we have a director that's come in the last 5 years and just is full of more ideas than our staff can handle.
Those are good directors, idea people. I mean, you got to execute it, but
But part of it is the local history department at the library really started back in the 1890s and 1900 with Debbie Martin. She started that core collection that I've been able to add to over these long years that I've been there, and that's why there was that importance in terms of local history. And we think so much now about the Packers bringing people to Green Bay, which they certainly do. I mean, give me that referendum and I'll vote for it again. But the years ago, like in the 40s and the 50s and the 60s even, what brought people to Green Bay many times was the history of the community in terms of who had been here, how it had functioned, and the French Canadians and all of those different groups. But the department has lots of material about not just strictly Green Bay or Brown County history, but in terms of the Packers, in terms of other communities in the area. And we have a great pamphlet file, you know, that we accumulated stuff in.
You're you want to get the right employees in the right jobs, and there's no question you're the person to do that. And I'm amazed by you, and I don't want to say how old you've been there for a little while.
50 years in the department.
50 years in the department.
Last January.
Okay, it was congratulations
That's
to you.
That's fantastic.
But, like, when I call you, you're there at 8 at night, and government has sometimes a tendency to, you know, leave a little, you know, right on time, 4:35. Yeah. But you love your job, and you as much data that's there, there's a lot that you can share just as a Mary Jane Herber.
Well, but part of being a local history librarian is that you just accumulate that because there's not a place to look for it.
But,
you know, it's not instant. You've got to be able to figure out how to do the different things, and it helps if you've got a great memory, and apparently I do. I don't know.
Mary Jane,
people say I do.
If you could go back, let's say, okay, you're in the business for 10 years at the time. If you could go back 40 years and just, you know, in a time capsule, what would you suggest to the leaders of Green Bay that maybe they didn't do as good as they could have done in retrospect to make this city what it is? Is there anything?
Or wow.
Because Jim and I was talking, Jim is still mad that they tore down the old city hall.
There's a couple things there, but we'll talk about that when you're on my show, too. I just think we've done a lot of stuff right, but I think we've made like 3 or 4 strategic mistakes. But I don't want to, the city's great. Right. I love
you
it.
You can save it for your other show then when you have her on Sunday. All right, fine.
I've got to think about it. There's some things that I've thought about that we've made mistakes on and little bumps in the road, and then sometimes it gets straightened out. And, you know, it took a long time to get the whole downtown thing. They tore it all down and
right.
it sat for
a long time.
Almost 10 years.
I thought it was a little longer than that. But we've made some 20, 30-year mistakes that, look, we'll talk about that some other time. But you're very positive. People can research. The library is there. Let's talk about what we've done right. I mean.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's a lot of good stuff. There's one of the things, I had a discussion with somebody once, and they were saying to me something about the new bridge south of Depere, the South Bridge. Mm-hmm. You know, and they said,
we were just talking about that.
Depere is going to have to pay for that. And I said, wait a minute. I said, you know, all the bridges across the Fox River in Brown County, people, see, this is where you got to think of these things broader. All the bridges across the Fox River in Brown County are all state highways or federal, like the Tower Drive, Frigo Bridge is. Fran always would get mad at me when I called it Tower Drive. But anyway.
Frigo deserves that.
That's right. He does.
That cost a governor his job when McClellan vetoed that. Yeah. I mean, he didn't get a vote in this city.
Anyway, but if you think about it, and the person said to me, and I said, but you know, we got 3 bridges in downtown Green Bay. They're all state highways.
Right.
And they kind of looked at me and I said, why didn't they divert one of those so that there's 2 bridges that were state highways and the other one could have been paid for by the city? And the person got so frustrated with me, they got up and walked out.
Wow. Well, that's why I'm struggling, because I'm trying to get a better recognition sign for Bart Starr on his bridge, you know, for the draft and everything. And I've gone to the county board and everything, and it's out of their hands because it's a state-run thing.
You got to get to the state.
Exactly. Right. Yeah, they would be all for it. They've even said that, but they can't do it because they're state.
Here's your advice.
Here's what you got to do. You got to get Rob Coles and the guys that aren't going to run again.
Oh, good point.
Those are the guys that'll do that.
They'll put their head on the block.
I'm calling Rob Coles. Yeah. Absolutely.
Poor Rob is going to be mad at me now.
No,
Rob's a good friend of mine.
He's a great representative,
right.
And me too. So, Mary Jane, let's say there's someone who's interested in your field of study.
Yeah.
Advice for, you got into this when you were very young.
Yeah.
But I'm just.
Start reading.
Yeah.
That's great advice.
I read the newspaper when I was in grade school every day. Now, granted, I wasn't reading the front page in terms of what they were doing about water or, you know, whatever. The other thing I got to say, it's about reading. And reading Time and reading Newsweek and reading, you've got to read. You've got to read. You've got to pay attention to what's going on, because you have to know what to do today and what to think about in terms of how it's going to affect down the road and how it's been affected by what's happened previously.
Outstanding. That's the question I was trying to get across. You just put it better than the question I just asked. You just gave me the answer for that. Yeah. So that's awesome.
That's great.
So thank you very much. Well, Mary Jane, tell me when Mary Jane's going to be on your show.
Sunday at 1 o'clock. She's going to be on Lean Local. We're going to talk about her knowledge, which is so broad, but we're going to talk about it more focused on the
political. We're just scratching the surface
here. Right. Mary Jane, we're going to have you back.
Okay.
Mary Jane, thank you so much for doing this. And thank you for all your help. And I think it's awesome what you do genealogy-wise for people.
Yes.
Well, we try hard to help them.
You do the
Sometimes
best.
They're scared.
But they're fine. All right. Thank you very much. Mary Jane Herber, librarian, historian, Brown County Library. One of the best you'll ever find. When we come back, the chef, Ace Champion, will be joining us. Maino the Mayor, back after this. Knowing,
but then I know it's growing strong. Wasn't the spring, and spring became the summer. Who'd have believed you'd come along? Hand, touching hands, reaching out.